Dear friends, what you're about to watch is a glimpse of what is currently happening behind the scenes. What you're about to see is a compilation of shocking events that are about to happen and will have a major impact on your personal life and those of your loved ones. In recent years, global unity has been promoted by world leaders and powerful entities who work persistently behind the scenes to advance their agenda. They are advocating plans for a new world order with the promise of ushering a one-world government that will bring about world peace, religious unity, economic equity, and social justice for every man, woman, and child. As a result, we are witnessing national governments, including the American government, that are increasingly trampling over their own constitution and national sovereignty to meet the political, economic, and social objectives of this new world order. We are also witnessing the emergence of powerful political alignments, financial institutions, and religious entities that play a major role behind the scenes. As the new world order is gaining momentum, the world is also witnessing greater social unrest, growing immorality, injustice, greed, and poverty, just as the prophesied mark of the beast is on the verge of being enforced worldwide. This video will look at the players who are supporters of the emerging new world order, their true intentions, and the power that is behind this global unity movement. Are we truly heading towards world peace, or will sudden destruction come upon those in the world? What role will the United States play in the near future? Will everyone receive the mark of the beast, as some believe will be the RFID chip that will monitor a person's ability to buy or sell? The answers to these questions and many more will be provided in this video from a biblical perspective.
The very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings. We decided long ago that the dangers of excessive and unwarranted concealment of pertinent facts far outweighed the dangers which are cited to justify it. Even today, there is little value in opposing the threat of a closed society by imitating its arbitrary restrictions. Even today, there is little value in ensuring the survival of our nation if our traditions do not survive with it. And there is very grave danger that an announced need for increased security will be seized upon by those anxious to expand its meaning to the very limits of official censorship and concealment. For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections.
The whole capitalist system has all the time as her own purpose is to infiltrate, to penetrate all the areas of life where the Roman Catholic can have control and access for the coming world government.
It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silent, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. No secret is revealed.
Vatican. For centuries, it has influenced world events, perhaps more than any other country on Earth. How could the world's smallest country wield such power?
The time for our leadership is now. It was the United States and the United Kingdom and our democratic allies that shaped a world in which new nations could emerge and individuals could thrive. And even as more nations take on the responsibilities of global leadership, our alliance will remain indispensable.
And this is here in the United States, they're all on these vehicles. We're in big trouble, people. We're in big trouble.
Thank you. HEMA is a front for a secret government, and the housing locations will actually serve as quarantine centers or internment camps. This is not an unfounded fear. After all, during World War II, the US forced over 100,000 Japanese Americans into government camps for the duration of the conflict, and civil unrest could be considered a domestic emergency. How would this insurrection occur? Theorists cite any number of possible causes, from the establishment of a one-world government to a national pandemic. Fringe researcher Mary Louise alleges that FEMA keeps a red list and a blue list, where people on the blue list will be shipped to camps for quarantine or re-education, while those on the red list will be executed. Skeptics rightly point out that this conspiracy requires an amazing, even implausible, level of organization. Also, a large natural disaster can displace hundreds of thousands of people, so building temporary housing in advance seems like a good idea. The federal government has indeed constructed massive housing facilities across the United States, from Oakdale, California to Atlanta, Georgia. Executive orders have given FEMA and other agencies increasingly broad emergency powers, even allowing the U.S. Army and Marine Corps to perform domestic operations.
Prisons are being built, internment camps constructed, and laws passed that deal severely with anyone who dares to step out of line or ask too many questions. There are approximately over 600 prison camps in the U.S., all fully operational and ready to receive prisoners. They are all staffed and even surrounded by full-time guards, but they are all empty. These camps all have railroad facilities, as well as roads leading to and from the detention facilities.
Pamela Schuffert reporting from North Carolina. I was riding on a bus from Butte, Montana to North Carolina, when I met a young man all dressed up in full and impressive Army Ranger uniform. He carried his 445 mag gun and many knives and several phones and military backpack and other equipment. He told me he was a staff sergeant from Fort Lewis. Fort Lewis is where many modern guillotines have been stored for a long time, for use in martial law. I teased him at first and told him I knew all about the modern guillotines in Fort Lewis. He was shocked. He said, "How did you know? This is highly classified information." I told him that the US military was not telling the young men like him, but these guillotines will be used on Americans and Christians in the future under martial law to behead all New World Order resistors. The longer he listened, the angrier he got. Using a few choice expletives, he said, "They never told us this would be used on Americans under martial law, to get rid of all Christians and New World Order resistors. We thought they would be used in Iraq or something."
Thus he said, "The fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down and break it in pieces."
patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. We ought to obey God rather than men. If ye love me, keep my commandments. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Circumcision is nothing, and uncircumcision is nothing, but the keeping of the commandments of God. And hereby we do know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us, by the Spirit which he hath given us. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. And this is love, that we walk after his commandments. This is the commandment, that as ye have heard from the beginning, ye should walk in it. And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life, and may enter in through the gates into the city.
We must wake up to this end-time truth before it is too late. The world as we know it, with its growing immorality, greed, poverty, and injustice, is coming to an end. The masses are so entertained today by the things of the world that they cannot see what is really happening. The poor health of today's human family has clouded their minds to recognize the real dangers that exist today. The Food and Drug Administration, the American Medical Association, along with other similar organizations, are poisoning and killing the masses with the purpose of depopulating the planet for the Vatican, though most who are working for these organizations are deceived themselves in thinking they are doing a good thing. Now is the time to get right with God before time runs out. Today in the United States, the federal government is working hard to disarm its citizens so as to make it easier for them to control the masses. Once they have disarmed the masses, as part of the Vatican's New World Order agenda, where they will enforce Sunday worship. As followers of Christ, let's put our faith in him and in his law, not in guns or in man's laws. As Christ mentioned in Luke chapter 3, verse 14,
do violence to no man.
And in Matthew chapter 5, verse 44, Christ mentions,
but I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you.
Many are claiming that there are other groups who are the leaders of the New World Order agenda, including the Illuminati, the Jesuits, the Knights Templar, the Knights of Columbus, the Freemasons, the Skulls and Bones, the Rothschilds, and other elites of the world. The truth of this matter is they all work under the direction of the Vatican. The Vatican hides behind them. They are all pawns that play a role for the Vatican. They all serve their master, Satan, through the Antichrist Pope who controls the world with all their wealth and power that Satan has given unto them. They are all working together in keeping the world at bay through lies, entertainment, sorceries, and deception, while uniting their forces to create a new world order through the Club of Rome to unite their stand with Satan and his rebellion against the Creator of the universe. The Roman Catholic Church has been instrumental in destroying the law of God, as Satan tried to do in heaven. The Battle of Armageddon continues till this day.
Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places.
The Ten Commandments of the Bible total 295 words in length, but the Roman Catholic Church's Ten Commandments have a total of only 77 words. The Catholic Church has removed 218 jots and tittles from the law of God, just as the prophet Daniel stated they would in Daniel chapter 7, verse 25.
And he shall think to change times and laws.
Christ knew that this Roman beast and harlot church would try to lead others from what true love is, which is found in the law of God, his holy Ten Commandments. Christ says,
Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself.
Christ is simply pointing us back to the law of God that is found in the Ten Commandments. The first four commandments teach us how to love the Creator, and the last six teach us how to love our neighbor. Jesus knew that the Vatican would change the law of God. Accordingly, Jesus Christ himself said in Matthew chapter 5,
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Heaven and earth have not passed away, and therefore the Vatican has no authority from heaven or in the scriptures to change the law of God. In fact, Christ, who is the law, which expresses his divine character, does not change.
For I am the Lord, I change not.
Will all who profess Christ as Lord make it to heaven?
Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity.
What is iniquity? Sin. What is sin?
For sin is the transgression of the law.
What is the end result in continuing to break the law of God?
For the wages of sin is death.
That so-called faith in Christ, which professes to release men from the obligation of obedience to God, is not faith, but presumption. By grace are ye saved through faith, but faith, if it had not works, is dead. Grace does not give us a free pass to commit sin, but grace is given unto us as a time period in which we have to repent and stop breaking the law of God that governs this universe, or pay the penalty, which is eternal death. Jesus said of himself before he came to earth,
I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart.
And just before he ascended again to heaven, he declared,
If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love.
The scripture says,
And hereby we do know that we know him, if we keep his commandments.
He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. He that saith he abideth in him hath himself also so to walk, even as he walked. In the first epistle of Peter, chapter 2, verse 21, we read,
For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps.
The prerequisite for eternal life is what it always has been, perfect obedience to the law of God, perfect righteousness through Christ Jesus who lives in you through the Holy Spirit. If eternal life was granted on any condition short of this, then the happiness of the whole universe would be imperiled. As the crowning act in the great drama of deception, Satan himself will impersonate Christ's second coming. The Protestant churches of today are keeping the Christian eyes on the nation of Israel, who has rejected Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The news media and the governments around the world are all in concert, working for Satan's soon arrival. The church has long professed to look to the Savior's return. Now the great deceiver will make it appear that Christ has come. In different parts of the world, Satan will manifest himself among men as a majestic being of dazzling brightness, resembling the description of the Son of God given by John in the book of Revelation.
One like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire, and his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters.
The glory that surrounds the false Messiah is unsurpassed by anything that mortal eyes have yet beheld. The shout of triumph rings out upon the air. Christ has come! Christ has come! The people prostrate themselves in adoration before him, while he lifts up his hands and pronounces a blessing upon them, as Christ blessed his disciples when he was upon the earth. His voice is soft and subdued, yet full of melody. In gentle, compassionate tones, the false Messiah presents some of the same gracious heavenly truths which the Savior uttered. Satan, as the false Messiah, heals the people of their diseases, and then, in his assumed character of Christ, the false Messiah claims to have changed the Sabbath to Sunday and commands all to hallow the day which he has blessed. He declares that those who persist in keeping holy the seventh-day Sabbath are blaspheming his name by refusing to listen to his angels sent to him with light and truth. This is the upcoming strong, almost overmastering delusion that will soon encompass the world. Like the Samaritans who were deceived by Simon Magus, who was the first real pope, the multitudes from the least to the greatest give heed to Satan's sorceries, saying, This is the great power of God, when it is not. But the people of God, the saints, who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus, will not be misled. They will recognize that the teachings of this false Christ are not in accordance with the scriptures. The blessing of the false Messiah is pronounced upon the worshippers of the beast and his image, which are given to those who sin against the law of God. It will be the same worshippers of the beast upon whom the Bible declares that God's unmingled wrath shall be poured out in the seven last plagues. And furthermore, Satan will not be permitted to counterfeit the manner of Christ's advent or second coming. The Savior has warned his people against deception upon this point, and has clearly foretold the manner of his second coming. Just prior to Christ's return, the Creator says,
For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, Behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers, believe it not. For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be.
True faith in God is obedience to him in all things. Those who choose to worship God on any other day other than his seventh-day Sabbath that he asks us to remember are worshiping him in vain and are rejecting him as the Creator. As it is written in Matthew chapter 15, verse 9.
But in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men.
The anticipated return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the King, cannot and will not be counterfeited. Christ will not step foot on this earth until he has destroyed it with hellfire, and the wicked have been judged and destroyed.
And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband.
His coming will be universally known and be witnessed by the whole world.
And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn, and they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other.
There will be no second chance for the unrepentant sinner. Now is the time to repent, to stop sinning, to keep the holy 10 commandments of God through the Holy Spirit, and to turn to the source of eternal life, our Lord, Savior, and Son of the Almighty God, Jesus the Christ. And as a gift, he will reward you with eternal life in his everlasting kingdom of love, peace, and joy. As Christ mentioned in Mark chapter 8, verse 38,
whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in the glory of his Father with the holy angels.
Are you still ashamed of Christ, the Son of the living God?
Choose you this day whom ye will serve.
To all those who strive to obey our Lord, Savior, and soon returning King, Jesus Christ, may the love, peace, and grace of the Most High be with you. God bless.